This show is part of the RetroZap.com podcast network.
Hi, this is Vanessa Marshall, voice of Hera and Rook Kast, and you're listening to Dennis and Jay on Podcast Stardust. Their behavior is continually unexpected.
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Hello, I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And welcome to episode 100 of Podcast Stardust, the galaxy's fully armed and operational podcast covering Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. Before we get any further, Jay, where can we be found around the internet?
Well, we can be found in a lot of places, but hey, episode 100, we got to congratulate ourselves, right? Right?
Mm-hmm, right.
And if you'd like to congratulate us, we are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And we can be reached by email at podcaststardust@retrozap.com. And gifts are always accepted.
All right. So, yes, this is episode 100. Thank you all for joining us. Since we got started back in the fall of 2019 and through all of our coverage of Resistance, books, comics, The Clone Wars, The Mandalorian, and The Rise of Skywalker, and then all of our various discussions with all of our guests from then till now, we have a very special guest for this episode. The one and only Vanessa Marshall, Hera, and Rook Kast herself will be joining us to discuss a little bit about the conclusion of the Clone Wars. And since we had her, we're asking her some of our questions about The Empire Strikes Back, since this is the 40th anniversary year. But yeah, we just had the conclusion to the Clone Wars, and we've been discussing the episodes on an episode per episode basis, but we're just going to kind of put a bow on the season and the final story arc today and discuss just a little bit about the Clone Wars overall. And we will get to our discussion with Vanessa in just a bit. So with that being said, there are going to be some spoilers if you haven't finished the season of Clone Wars. And if you don't want to hear those, then go ahead and come back to this episode at a later day. So Jay, overall, what did you think of the final arc in season 7 of the Clone Wars and compared to maybe the other seasons and how this whole thing went?
Well, for me, it was a gift. And, you know, I know that I've said this before and speaking for other fans of the Clone Wars itself, is that we finally got our ending. We finally got our conclusion. We got our closure. And, you know, it was just so great. The anticipation even leading up to this final season from the time that it was announced at Comic-Con a couple of years ago with the hashtag Clone Wars saved, all the way up until the very last tears as the episodes ended. It was such a ride. And, you know, it was everything that I'd hoped that it would be. And I got even more than I hoped that it would be. And it was a lot of fun. And it's, you know, this whole Clone Wars epic saga has really spanned a lot of time. It's, what, 12 years altogether?
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, there's so much to it that, you know, we're getting it into with our discussion as well. But the icing on the cake was definitely this last season, and I couldn't have asked for more.
Mm-hmm. So of the three story arcs that we got this past season, which one was your favorite?
Oh, do you have to ask? Of course, with the Ahsoka arc, because the Siege of Mandalore and everything is just... it's just so Star Wars. And not that the other two weren't. And I love the Bad Batch. If I had to put them 1, 2, 3, it would definitely be the Siege of Mandalore with Order 66, followed by the Bad Batch, and then the Trace and Rafa episodes with Ahsoka's walkabout. And not that I didn't like those episodes, because I did. And I do feel that they actually lent a lot more character development to Ahsoka herself and learning a little bit more about herself and putting things into perspective once she had left the Jedi Order. But that's my ranking.
Yeah, I can't really disagree with that. I think you nailed it, with the Siege of Mandalore being the best, the Bad Batch being second best, and then the sisters, the Martez sisters, being the third best. I mean, there really was no worst. They were all good story arcs. But I think the first and third story arc were really more the stories that we wanted out of the season. And you know, especially with all the tie-ins of the Siege of Mandalore to the Revenge of the Sith, just added something extra that perhaps that middle arc didn't have as good as it was. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the other thing was, is that the first and third arc had a larger cast from the other seasons of the Clone Wars, you know, more Anakin involvement, more Obi-Wan involvement, and, you know, Rex's involvement. Whereas that middle arc, although it had a little bit of Anakin in it, mm-hmm. largely was almost all Ahsoka when it came to our traditional Clone Wars cast.
Right, right.
So here's something I want to discuss a little bit about this season, is that would you agree that overall it was perhaps maybe the darkest season of the Clone Wars that we got?
You know, not really. I mean, in some ways, yes, because of the gravity of Order 66 and everything that it means to the entire storyline and the, you know, the entire, you know, mythos of Star Wars. But, you know, there were a lot of really dark things that happened. I mean, the Night Sisters were spooky, you know, mm-hmm. that whole arc. And, you know, there was a lot of things that went to a really dark place. I mean, Mortis was really dark. So I feel like that there was a lot of lightheartedness throughout the series, but I do feel that there was a lot of dark in there too. And I think that we've talked about this before too, that just overall Clone Wars has a much more adult feel to it, even though that it's been marketed and, you know, is kind of supposed to be for kids because it's this animated series. There are a lot of really mature themes and mm-hmm. a lot of really dark things that actually do happen.
Well, I was not trying to suggest that the other seasons were light, all light considering it. But in my opinion, on an episode per episode basis, this season was far darker than the prior seasons that preceded it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I guess my comparison would be this, is that, you know, take a look at season one. You know, the very first episode is Yoda and King Katunko trying to handle Asajj Ventress on that. And, you know, there was a lot of more humor in that. And then you got episodes like, you know, dealing with the Lerman and the Defenders of Peace and that type of an episode. And it had a darker into it. But I just kind of felt that, especially where this season ends with Anakin as Darth Vader, Order 66 having been called, and the galaxy having been left in a dark place, there's, in tone overall, I felt like this season was darker than any other season overall. Mm-hmm. You know, you're right, absolutely right, that, you know, things like Mortis and even some of the other story arcs that were thrown in there on occasion could be darker. I just felt like this season was, on an episode per episode basis, was probably darker than the others that preceded it. But
sure. Yeah, and I think too that the season itself was much shorter than other seasons as well. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we had what, like 12, 15 episode seasons in some of the other seasons. So, you know, this really, yeah, I mean, overall as a season, absolutely more dark than all mm-hmm. the rest. So there wasn't as much opportunity to have levity. And, you know, that was the whole point was to address these things. And that's exactly what we got.
Yeah. I'm wondering, and this is kind of impossible to tell because I don't really know anyone who's watched the Clone Wars that hasn't then seen the movies. If all you knew about Star Wars is the Clone Wars and you started with, you know, maybe the movie or episode one, that Yoda episode I was just talking about, and you finished here, what your impression of Star Wars would be, how mm-hmm. the galaxy just fell apart and the good guys ultimately lost. And we have no idea what the fate of Obi-Wan is. You wouldn't necessarily know that Anakin became Darth Vader and all of that. And that's not a criticism. I mean, like I said, it's highly unlikely that anyone who's seeing this hasn't seen many of the Star Wars movies and knows that Anakin becomes Darth Vader. But at the end of this series, there is nothing explicit that tells you what happened to Obi-Wan, that Anakin in fact became Darth Vader, other than that vision that Anakin or that Ahsoka had aboard mm-hmm. the cruiser, that, you know, something has happened to Anakin.
Right. And, you know, and because we've been fans of this for so long, but I think as you were talking about that, I was thinking about some of the conversations that even you and I have had with people that have children mm-hmm. and that for them, this is for some of them, the only thing that they've ever known. And that there's been some conversations for parents that have come out of this in terms of, you know, what the perspective is from a child's point of view, you know, truly wonderful the mind of a child is, as Yoda would say. But yeah, it's that's a really, really good question in terms of how things would be different, how you would see things differently. But again, you know, we've said over and over again that just the idea of watching the Clone Wars makes Anakin's descent to the dark side that much harder to watch because you get to know him so much more. So yeah, but if it was the only thing that you know, yeah, that's a really good question.
Yeah. So on a more lighthearted note, what was perhaps your, we talked about the story arcs and we ranked them, but did you have a favorite episode over the course of the season?
I would probably have to say the Phantom Apprentice was my favorite episode overall. And only because of the fact that, you know, we got to get so much of the action that we've been thirsting for and that I've played out in my mind so many times and, you know, wanted to see on screen, and I finally got it.
Yeah, I agree with you on that one, that was perhaps the favorite episode. And, you know, while we're talking about it, it's like each one of those episodes of that final story arc were spectacular for their own reason. And we had the, you know, the first episode with Ahsoka getting the Mandalore, and that was in some incredible action, and it was, you know, pulse pounding. And then the second episode had the duel between Ahsoka and Maul. Third episode, Shattered, was already 66. And then the fourth episode was Escape. So they all had, these were all episodes of significance, mm-hmm. with their own individual tie-ins to Revenge of the Sith. And I think that makes it hard to pick just one of the episodes as a favorite or as a best. But I think it has to be one of those four. As much as I enjoyed the action for the Bad Batch, I just wish we'd gotten them earlier in the series, maybe like in season two or three, so we had more opportunities to see them in action. And kind of hold out hope that somewhere along the way, we'll get more episodes that deal with them in some fashion, whether it's an individual series or if they decide to make more Clone Wars, they do something. I doubt they'll make actually another season of this, but it would be fun to follow up with some more of their adventures, whether it's in a comic or something. But I want to know more about the Bad Batch and everything they did.
Yeah, like Clone Wars Chronicles or something, you know, just side stories and things would be great. What, you know, speaking of the Bad Batch too, this is something that's been on my mind with Order 66. You know, we've talked a little bit about how they were very different from the other clones. Obviously they were the special unit. Did they have the inhibitor chip? Did they not? You know, we talked a little bit about that, but I'm wondering what Order 66 was like for them.
That's a good question. Yeah. They typically didn't work with the Jedi or with the other clones, as they said. So when Order 66 was ordered, did it make a difference to them at all? Or were they then sent to hunt down some Jedi because they're so good at special missions? That would be... That would be fascinating. You could do a whole lot with them. Similarly, right. I'd kind of like to see more of the Martez sisters, but perhaps in a book format where there's a bit more of exploration of what they did, say like 3 or 4 years later, how they would have seen Order 66 and the state of the galaxy after the Emperor took control.
Mm-hmm. That's why I think like a Clone Wars Chronicles would be fun, you know, and almost like from a certain point of view, you know, the book that we got for the 40th anniversary of A New Hope, you know, some of these little things that show different perspectives. I just think that would be super cool.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, it's just about time for our discussion with Vanessa Marshall, but did you have any final thoughts you want to share about season 7?
Season 7 in general, I think I've said all that there is to say, but you know, just Clone Wars in general, this is something that my children were brought up on too, and they're now 18 and 20. And for them, this is their childhood. And you know, at the time when I was watching this with them, I appreciated it differently. I gobbled it up more than anything else because, you know, when you have young children, you don't really have a whole lot of time to sit and dissect different, you know, things and whatnot. But now that I've gotten a chance to go back and revisit it myself, as well as with my 18-year-old son, it's such a great thing to have as something that we can share. And, you know, over these, what we said, 12 years, I think there's 131 episodes. This has really become ingrained into our psyches and into our histories, both personally and from a family perspective. So I'm just so happy that we were, like I said, able to finish it with season 7 and really bring it to the closure that it really deserved.
Yeah, I'm with you on that. I know when the announcement was made that we were getting this final season of the Clone Wars, I had recorded it or shown it on the television on YouTube to my kids, and they had no idea what they were about to see. But as soon as they started hearing Rex's voice and they saw the helmets and then the announcement of that this season was coming, you know, just them both jumping up and down and getting really excited about it. Because again, this was also their introduction to Star Wars. And it was too bad because, you know, I'd always hoped one day to kind of get their reaction to finding out how Anakin became Darth Vader by showing them The Empire Strikes Back, you know, that reveal. But, you know, classmates had spoiled that for them. So, but, you know, this was still a fun reveal to see their reaction to, and then to watch this final season with them at this older age when they understood all the history and everything that came before. So, all right. Well, with that being said, let's have our discussion with Vanessa Marshall. All right. So now we are pleased to welcome Vanessa Marshall, the voice of Hera Syndulla herself, to Podcast Stardust. Vanessa, thank you so much for appearing. How are you doing?
Thank you so much. I'm so happy to be here. All is well in the middle of a pandemic.
Yeah, we're all doing as best we can.
Well, we just had Star Wars Day, so it doesn't get better than that, really.
Yes, yes. Yeah. And I did catch you on the live stream, on the Facebook live stream.
So that
was a lot of fun, sharing your banana story and...
Yes, my banana story and my Leku stories, and I had many more items for show and tell, but we didn't get around to them.
It's always hard, but you've been all over the place. So you've definitely been doing so much with Star Wars and with all of your other voiceovers and that type of thing. And I know you just had two more things that just came out, one for Mortal Kombat. Do you want to just touch on that just real quickly?
There's a Mortal Kombat 11. It's a game. I play a character called Shiva. And today, it's May 6th. They just released new content that includes Shiva. And so that's awesome. It's a really cool game. Yeah. And then I was in Rick and Morty's episode. I think it was either the 4th or the 5th. I don't know. It was Monday or Tuesday of this week. On Adult Swim, I got to play a couple roles, but one of them was Ruth Bader Ginsburg, which is pretty funny.
That is awesome.
Notorious RBG, yeah.
That is super awesome.
Yeah, so those two things happened in conjunction with our phenomenal Star Wars Celebration Week. So, very happy. Yeah.
You're always, as Obi-Wan would say, always on the move. That's for sure. So yes, and of course our listeners are most familiar with your work on Star Wars, Rebels, and now Clone Wars. But realistically, I mean, you have had your hand in so many different types of projects. So pretty much anywhere someone turns, they're liable to find Vanessa Marshall.
Well, there have been a couple DC things recently. If you like the DC world, we're such diehard Star Wars people, but... I play Wonder Woman and Giganta in the cartoon called Harley Quinn on the DC streaming service. And I also just played Wonder Woman in a film that came out, an animated movie called Red Son, which is sort of an Elseworlds tale asking the question, what if Superman landed in the Soviet Union instead of America? And Wonder Woman serves as this sort of ambassador of peace between those two countries, and it's really, really well done. So those were some DC things that I've done recently.
Wow, that is super interesting. Well, I know a lot of our listeners are definitely like, we're all over the board too, you know, with Marvel and DC and all kinds of things, Star Trek. So, but yeah, let's talk some Star Wars.
Yay.
Yay. So congrats on playing Rook Kast.
Yes.
Exciting. So how exciting was it playing a Mandalorian, especially one in the Clone Wars, especially after starring in Rebels alongside Tia Sakaar as Sabine?
Oh, man. Oh, well, my favorite hashtag is Mando for life. So I'm definitely a hardcore Mandalorian fan. I think it was San Diego Comic-Con 2014 that Tia and I got inducted into the Mandalorian Mercs, and they gave us each a Sabine helmet and a Sabine... air gun or whatever her air blaster that she paints with. I think she would have gotten a gun, but I got something that's like an airbrush instrument that she uses for her art. But anyway, it was just, that was a magical experience cut to actually playing a Mandalorian. It's really, really just mind blowing. Yeah, I couldn't believe it. And then of course, you know, I've seen in the comic book, I've seen sort of what she looks like, but I was curious to see what she would look like in the actual cartoon. And so that was an added bonus when I got to see her purple hair and how cool she looked. She almost looked like a distant relative of Sabine's. So that made it even more cool. So hopefully I can cosplay as Rook Kast and embrace all her amazing features.
Oh my gosh, that would be so awesome. And of course, we've gotten a chance to talk to you before too on our predecessor podcast, Starship Sabers and Scoundrels. And I know we had talked about wanting to do cosplay Mandalorian. You know, you've always wanted to do that. So
that's
this is
right.
Like a dream come true.
I'm a huge Bo-Katan fan, and that was sort of my goal. But yeah, we'll see. Stay tuned.
I'm glad to hear you say that you thought that Rook Kast looked something like Sabine, because that's what I thought as well. And I wasn't sure if that's what they were going for, because the Ursa Wren also shows up in the course of this season as well. But when it came to playing a Mandalorian, Rook seemed like such a different character than Hera. How did you approach that role? What did you think about? What did you do in order to make that something unique?
Well, first of all, she was organized spiritually sort of in a much deeper place, deeper in terms of her sound and resonance, as opposed to Hera's sort of lighter, more heartfelt, hopeful sound. You know, she perpetrates evil. So, or you know, one could argue one way or the other that she's doing the right thing, you know, from her point of view. Yeah, we wanted to definitely distinguish her from Hera, and that's why we went lower and also with a British accent. And given what she's trying to accomplish for her lord, Darth Maul, she has her task ahead of her. And we just sort of had her play those intentions as they were revealed.
And okay, you just mentioned the British accent. That's something I also want to touch on, because when you did Hera, you had the episode where you did a French accent. And yeah, you had talked about how you could speak French. So I can't do a British accent. How difficult is that to do and to get into?
Well, I went to undergrad at Princeton University, majored in English, and got a master's or a certificate in theater, and then went on to NYU Tisch School of the Arts and got a master's in acting from their graduate program. And one of the things that we did within the 3 years that we were all in school together was study dialects. I am also a huge Anglophile. My entire house is decorated, of course, with Star Wars, but second to that is there are British flags everywhere, all over the place. So I studied theater at the British Youth Academy. Oh gosh, I think I was like 14 years old. I went over there and studied theater, and have been going over there every chance I can get ever since then. So I have a fondness for all things UK. So that makes it easier to sort of imitate the people that I know who live over there. I have tons of friends and family, and so that's helpful. As opposed to Australia, I've never been down to Australia, so that accent is purely academic. And I have many friends who speak French, so I'm able to do the French accent through that. But we did study the dialects, and that has been very valuable as I've gone along.
Well, what's super crazy to me is the fact that, you know, this was all kept so under wraps. And, you know, when I watched the Clone Wars and then I saw the credits at the end, I thought, oh my gosh. And then I had messaged you right away and I was like, Rook Kast, huh? And you're like, yep. So that was, how hard was that to keep all of that under wraps?
Well, it's easy if you sign an NDA.
Well, yeah, but.
It definitely was difficult, but a lot of people asked me to do podcasts and I kept saying, do you mind if we wait? Do you mind if we wait? Do you mind if we wait? Because I knew that this was coming, and I would rather us sort of celebrate the Clone Wars together. You know, not only Rook Kast, but just in general, that I just felt like there would be more to discuss if we just paused. So it's sort of like throwing a surprise party. It's totally worth it because we all get to just have a great time on the night of. So it's not as hard as you might think. I think when I got the role of Hera and I couldn't talk about it for a year, and people kept asking why I was so happy, it was just like, well, I had a good workout. I don't know, you know, that I started to feel dishonest, like lying by omission, but you know, this was easier to sort of wait for my friends to experience as we all did together watching the episode.
Sure.
Well, okay, so what did you think about this final season of The Clone Wars overall?
It was perfect. It was absolutely perfect. I needed it right now. It was everything. You know, it's interesting, in the Ahsoka arc, a friend of mine was like, have you watched it yet? And I had to sort of catch up on it to be able to discuss it with her. And I was like, look, when we talk, just, I'm probably going to be sobbing. Just deal with it. And, you know, her first 4 episodes, I didn't really sob as I had expected. It was not that it was lighthearted, but it was very plot driven. And it wasn't until she saw Anakin that I lost it. Mm-hmm. And from that moment forward, my soul was impaled. Mm-hmm. it was electrifying. Every moment, every sound, every color, every gesture, every fight. Oh my gosh, that the whole last arc was just exquisite. And I really have no words to describe how grateful I am that this season happened, to have been a part of it, and for it to have ended in such a deeply spiritual way, with Ahsoka putting her lightsaber down. It killed me. Yeah.
Yeah, I think we all pretty much felt the same way. And yeah, it's like you said, it's something that we all needed this. And it was a long time coming. And I agree with you completely. This whole resolution and just what we got was just done so artfully. So was there something, a moment in particular? You mentioned the moment with Anakin when Anakin showed up, but was there anything else in particular that just really stood out to you, or maybe your favorite scene?
I think when Rex is restored and he's reunited, oh, I can't even talk about it without crying.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that just, it meant so much. I don't know why that the way they communicated once he came back from Order 66, it reverberated through all of Rebels. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
It just moved me. It was so perfect. And then, of course, the moments between Anakin and Ahsoka, and then the moments where she doubts Darth Maul and believes in Anakin. Mm-hmm. So sad.
You got me crying over here, girl, too. I'm telling you what.
I just, you know, when Darth Maul says your whole life has come down to this moment, it really did. And then, you know, when we cut to the end of the season in Rebels, when she fights Anakin or Darth Vader at that point, so many seeds. Oh my gosh. So it wasn't just rippling through Rebels. It was also rippling through Episode 3, the film, you know, while Order 66 was happening off camera for the Clone Wars, right? Mm-hmm. I knew he was killing younglings.
Yeah.
I knew, you know, when we hear Obi-Wan, no, Anakin, you know, I knew. That we were losing Sky Guy, you know?
Right.
I don't know why, it just really impacted me in a way that, it's exactly the way the Clone Wars all along would deepen it. Well, Episode 3, the film, for me, was made so much more specific, knowing the relationship between Snips and Anakin. And there were different moments between Ahsoka and Darth Maul, and Ahsoka and Rex, and things that were, of course, they held their own in the Clone Wars, but the way that they beautifully underlined what follows, I just have no words to describe how grateful I am for how artfully it was handled. It was just perfect.
And, you know, and this is what I'm speaking for all the fans listening right now too, that we love about you, Vanessa, is that you love Star Wars as much as we do. And you are a true fan, and you get it. You get it on such a deep level, not just because you've played the characters, because it's in your heart and in your soul. And that's what we appreciate so much about you. And, you know, it is a family. And just like with Rebels, when you all had the ghost and the family there, you know, it's just an extension of that family. And it's such a beautiful, beautiful thing.
Yeah.
It really is.
I was just going to say, from the original Clone Wars, when Ahsoka walks away from the Jedi, that moment is etched in time and space forever and ever. And the fact that we got several more moments like that in this final season was just the most delicious gift in the world. So anyway, what were you going
to
say, Dennis?
Great, great way to put it. Go ahead, Dennis.
No, I was just going to mention, you know, it was one of the things I noticed about these last four episodes of the Clone Wars is it was an incredibly dark tone that we got throughout the four of them. And especially with the music, it was haunting. It very much brought about that Revenge of the Sith vibe to it. But I had the chance earlier today to sit down and watch some episodes of Rebels, and I came across, it was the fourth, fifth, or sixth episode of season two, where Ahsoka sends Kanan and the crew to find Rex. And at the end of that episode, Rex rendezvous with Ahsoka, and they get to come back face to face, and they have that hug. And it was the most uplifting thing.
Yeah.
After watching these past few episodes and everything that those two had gone through together.
Exactly. Exactly. It'll never be the same. It'll never be the same.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we've talked a lot about the how perfect this season was, but looking back on the Clone Wars overall, what was your favorite part of it? What excited you the most about the Clone Wars when you were seeing the episodes?
You mean from beginning to end?
Yes.
Well, that's a great question. Speaking of Darth Maul, if we go back to when he returned, and the Night Sisters and all that befell him and his brother Savage Opress, and of course Asajj Ventress is involved, that was probably some of the most haunting animation I have ever seen. I also really loved the episodes on Onderon, which of course included Saw Gerrera, because I think that definitely set the tone for the rebellion that followed. But I mean, there were a million moments that I loved. I mean, season six had so many things with Qui-Gon and Yoda that enriched so much for me in terms of, you know, like the afterlife and things that are beyond the realm that we know. Many of those scenes still haunt me. Like I said, that one particular moment where Ahsoka leaves the Jedi Order, that's definitely the most profound moment of them all.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I think that was for a lot of us, for sure. For sure.
Yeah. Yeah. But I mean, I'm just like thinking back, there were just so many great scenes, all the different scenes with Snips and Anakin. I loved the way they cared for each other, you know? It was beautiful to watch.
Yeah, and one of the things that Dennis and I have often said too is getting to know Anakin in the Clone Wars makes watching his fall that much harder. You know? It's just, it makes it so much more personal in that way.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. I mean, that definitely is why episode three is so devastating after watching the Clone Wars.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. Well, you know, what is it? 133 episodes. We're back to have different things that resonate throughout, for sure. So have you mentioned a little bit about Son of Dathomir, that you looked at that for, you know, to get to know what Rook Kast looked like. So I've always wanted to know, do you get a chance to ever explore, you know, any of the other media in which Hera or Rook Kast has appeared? You know, I mentioned Son of Dathomir, or, you know, A New Dawn, or Alphabet Squadron for Hera, or any of those kinds of things? Or are you just so super busy?
No, I actually, A New Dawn I definitely read. I have everything. I have like a million books by my bed. I was definitely able to read A New Dawn, and that was exceedingly helpful. The comic book was also helpful. But those are the only two that I've had the opportunity to dive into yet. But like I said, everything's by my bed, so I have stuff to look forward to.
Well, you are very busy, and that's a good problem to have, especially right now.
Oh, definitely. I couldn't be more grateful. I'm so grateful to be useful and, you know, help out. And like I said, I have these different radio stations that I do in Canada. They're different rock stations, and in the middle of a pandemic, there are all sorts of really important announcements that need to be made. So it's just great to be helpful.
That's fantastic.
Yeah. Well, changing gears just a little bit, we've been celebrating the 40th anniversary of The Empire Strikes Back this year, and we've been largely doing it in 10 to 12 minute chunks of the film. We'll analyze those for an entire episode of our podcast, but we've been just asking our guests some general questions about The Empire Strikes Back. So I was kind of hoping we could finish up this discussion with a few of your thoughts on The Empire Strikes Back.
Okay.
Yeah. First off, do you remember watching Empire Strikes Back for the first time? And if so, what was that experience like for you?
Yes, I do remember it. And I loved the scenes between Han and Leia. Those are my favorite. Everything that went on between the two of them was so great. And I kept thinking of that when I had scenes with Kanan in different hallways that were quite similar.
Oh, that's Aww, good. That's awesome. Really good. Yeah.
What's your favorite scene, if you had to pick one, other than, you know, the scenes with Han and Leia, obviously?
Honestly, it would be the Han, I think when they're escaping Hoth and they're together in the hallway. That I don't know why that one just cracks me up. It just cracks me up and it touches me. It moves me. Yeah. Mm-hmm. How about you guys? What are your favorite scenes?
Oh, I'm all about the Battle of Hoth.
Yes.
I mean, I was six when this movie came out, and although A New Hope was the first movie I ever saw in a theater with my dad, but Empire Strikes Back was the first one I remembered, and I was all about AT-AT's everything for years after that. So, yeah, that was my favorite.
Yeah, wasn't that amazing?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Mine was always the scene with Yoda, you know, with just after he calms down after being so goofy and explains the Force, and that just stuck with me.
Yeah, that is an incredible scene, actually. Yeah.
Well,
I love the whole film. I just thought from beginning to end, it was amazing. So, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right. Where would you rank it amongst the films?
It's my favorite. It's definitely my favorite. Yeah, for sure.
That tends to be the answer we get. It's either 1 or 1A for just about everybody.
Yeah, definitely.
It's true. So who would you say is your favorite character?
Leia.
I love it. And what did you like about her? I just want to know, you know, as far as seeing her for the first time and then, you know, as you grew to, you know, into your own maturity as a character and as a Star Wars fan, has it changed? Or have you pretty much just always seen Leia, you know, in the same light?
I think I've seen her pretty much in the same light. I think she sort of softened a bit as we went along, but she only sort of relaxed into her power without needing to be so sardonic, maybe. Mm-hmm. But her moxie, 100%, is what I wanted to embody since day one.
Mm-hmm.
But I love her integrity, her generosity of spirit. At the end of the day, you know, no matter how much she says to get this walking carpet out of her way, she really cares about people and doing the right thing. And that I find the most moving aspect of her personality of all. And I think it's consistent to the very end.
I love that. And the reason that I ask that is because Leia was actually my very first female role model growing up, because I had seen the original Star Wars when I was 7. And so I would often role play, you know, and what would Leia do? What would Leia do? And so when I hear those things often repeated in different media, I think, gosh, I was the same way. What would Leia do? So that's why I was super curious about that.
Oh, definitely. Definitely. Definitely.
So the last question I have about The Empire Strikes Back that I have is, do you prefer the original theatrical version or the special edition version of the film? And there's no right answer to this.
Well, I think I prefer the original only because it's what I experienced spiritually first. However, I'm not opposed to the one that followed necessarily. It's not like, oh, I hate the second, you know, I'll watch either or and always. So mm-hmm. I don't know, but I think what's really sort of what landed on my heart instantly was the first version. And so to a certain extent, I just have a more sort of particular affection for it with the memories attached to when I saw it and so on. But you know, I also have memories for the time frame when I saw the second version, but the first time I saw it, it was just, I don't know. It just really, it's at that, the first version, I would say. Yeah. How about you guys?
Oh, for me, I prefer the special edition just because I like what they did with Cloud City. The way they opened it up, we get all the sunset colors inside the city. We get to see the Falcon fly through the cityscape, and it just makes that whole area more beautiful than it was to begin with. But beyond that, I don't really have a preference because, unlike A New Hope, they changed significantly less with Empire Strikes Back than they did. So that's
true. Yeah.
For me, I was so young when I saw the original version that by the time the special edition came out, I guess I didn't realize the changes that they had made, because I had seen Return of the Jedi the most in the theaters. So that was the one that stuck with me and resonated with me, I think, more when I was younger. So when the special editions came out, it wasn't anything for me that was mind-blowingly different until people started bringing things to my attention that were different. So it was all Star Wars and it was all good, you know? It was still the same story.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I don't care which version you put on. I'll watch it.
Right.
Yeah.
We just wanted to, thank you for your time. I know you're incredibly busy lately. You mentioned your work with Canadian stations and everything else you've been doing. But before you go, where can everyone find you and what you're up to? And what else do you have going on that you want to make sure everyone knows about?
Please find me on Twitter at Van Marshall, and over on Instagram I'm at Vanessa Marshall 1138. I'll have all kinds of updates with things as I'm legally able to discuss them. This week with the Rick and Morty episode that came out, and of course the Clone Wars and the ongoing Harley Quinn stuff, there are new episodes that are constantly up there. If you haven't checked out the DC Universe, there's a role-playing game. Sam Witwer is the DM, and Freddie is in it. It's a DC role-playing game, but we have a lot of fun playing together. There's a bunch of us, and if you liked the Star Wars role-playing game that we did on Freddie's channel, Good Evening and Good Game, Gegghead, GG, I believe it is. Go check that out. It's the DC All-Stars game. It's a good laugh.
Oh, that's super cool. So, and also, I would love it if you would just say a few words about the Step Up organization that you work with, because that one's really near and dear to my heart, working with teenage girls, because I'm a high school teacher. So could you just say a couple words about that?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Step Up Women's Network is something that I discovered a few years ago. And I actually, when I went to volunteer to sort of mentor the young girls, they were like, you do what? And I was like, yeah, well, I do cartoons and this and that. And the kids were like, I'd rather work with a lawyer or a producer or a banker, or it doesn't sound like a very stable profession. And I went up to the women who run the thing, and I was like, you know what? How about if I'm your social media person, and I can help you guys that way? But basically, Step Up Women's Network helps support young girls to apply for jobs with their college entrance essays, etc. And they give them internships and stuff like that to help them succeed in life. So it's women helping girls become women in the workforce and in academia. And it's just a beautiful support system. And I love their generosity of spirit as well. So, I think I gave you the link, but definitely Step Up Women's Network is worth checking out.
That's wonderful, because that's one thing that I know I deal with a lot is, just the relationships between girls and girls and women. And that's such a great, great organization. So thank you for the work that you're doing with that.
Definitely. Thank you for asking about it. I'm honored to be involved with them. So they will appreciate the mention. Their exact phrase is, "We inspire professional women to inspire teen girls through after school and weekend mentorship programs." So that's sort of the very basic through line of what they're up to.
Perfect. All right.
Well, Vanessa, thanks again for coming on Podcast Stardust and helping us celebrate our 100th episode. I can't think of a better way to have done it.
Awesome. Thanks so much, you guys. I'm so grateful that we got this time together, and I look forward to us being together in person soon.
Yes, absolutely. Definitely. All right. Take care.
Thank you so much, you guys. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
All right. So that was Vanessa. That was really nice of her to give us some time. When we did talk to her, she was in the middle of an extremely busy day, and she easily could have set this aside, because before the recording had even started, she'd be given another several pages of work to do. But still, she kept the appointment and gave us the time she had. And I know that I speak for both of us when I say that we both really appreciated that she still managed to make that happen for us.
Oh, yeah. And that just shows how wonderfully generous she is, and genuine, too, because like you said, she could have very easily, you know, canceled, and it would have been totally understandable. You know, life happens and she has her professional obligations, but fans come first, and she's always been that way. And I know she always will be. So may the force be with you, Vanessa. We love you.
Yeah. And if you ever do have Vanessa showing up at a convention at some point in the future near you, make sure you get out and meet her. She is spectacular in the convention setting, especially if she's doing a panel. I know I've talked about meeting her at Fan Expo Dallas last year, and the panel that she put together, the one woman panel that she did, and it was simply amazing. So make sure you get a chance to check her out. All right. Well, then, thank you all for listening to another episode of Podcast Stardust, our big 100th episode with Vanessa Marshall. We'd like to remind you that you can find all episodes of Podcast Stardust at our home over on RetroZap.com. And you can subscribe to Podcast Stardust wherever it is that you get your podcasts, including Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Overcast, or wherever it is that you listen to your podcasts. We are, of course, part of the RetroZap Podcast Network. If you subscribe to the network feed, you'll get this show and all the other great shows in one convenient place. And we would also love it if you could head over to Apple Podcasts and rate and review the show. 5 stars with a couple sentences about what it is that you like about the show goes a long way towards helping others find the show and what Podcast Stardust is all about. With that being said, Jay, could you let everyone know where they can find us on social media and around the internet?
I would love to. You can find us on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. Dennis is at DJKVER2 over on Twitter, and I am at Joyce Krebs. You can also check out our Pinterest page. We have a YouTube channel, and you can email us your thoughts at podcaststardust@retrozap.com. Have you joined us over on Discord yet? If not, what are you waiting for? Check out how to do that in our show notes. We have our own dedicated room over there on the RetroZap Discord server, and you can also interact with all the other great RetroZap shows as well as other dedicated rooms devoted to a lot of geekery kinds of things. And we'd love it if you could check us out on TeePublic, where we are teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust. And there's tons and tons of different types of apparel designs, tons and tons of different apparel and designs of our show logo, including now masks. So when you have to go out into public and you want to protect yourself and others, you can grab a Podcast Stardust mask. Who wouldn't want one? Thanks to Corey Club from Coffee with Kenobi for all those great designs.
All right. That'll do it then for episode 100 of Podcast Stardust. Thanks for listening, everyone. And until next time, may the force be with you.